भुनक्तु सवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं परमात्मनं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। So the first lesson we saw, 9 blessings of human life. What are those 9? Another Janma, human birth.
Manliness.
Homestorm, manliness. Viprata, sattvic qualities. Vaidika dharma madhu parata, steadfastness in the spiritual practices. Vidvatva, knowing the essence of the Vedic knowledge. Atma and Atma vivechana, the discrimination between self and non-self. Swanubhava, direct experience. Brahmatmana samsthiti, not only a glimpse but firm establishment. Mukti, freedom from this cycle of birth and death. All these 9 can come to a person because of the punyas one has done in the many, many lives. Crores of how, which lives? Human lives. So to cultivate these 9 blessings, also punya is required. And punya comes through many methods that we will see as we go along. Now today we will see, before any Vedantic text starts, there are a few important aspects. So any Vedantic composition, generally, not only Vedantic composition, any field you will see, there are 2 types of texts. One is called as the Shastra Grantha, other is called as Prakarana Grantha. So we need preparation. So they are called Prakarana Grantha, introductory or preliminary texts. So what is Shastra Grantha? Shastra has a beautiful meaning, different meanings it has. Etymological meaning. Etymology means the word itself has a meaning inherent in it. Sanskrit is a beautiful language in that sense that if you open up that word, the meaning will reveal. So Shastra literally means Shasti iti Shastram. That which instructs, first meaning of the word is that which instructs. And what kind of instruction? All round holistic instruction. On that particular subject, it will cover all aspects. Like Arthashastra will cover all aspects of economics. Same way here in Vedanta. The main Shastra book will cover all aspects of Vedanta, not selected few. Complete. The whole science of that is in this Shastra. So one is that which instructs. By covering the topic holistically, it gives clear instructions. Second is that which rules. Shasti. Shasan, you know, in Hindi the word is shasan. Shasan means to rule. Shasana, shasanat, shastram. That which rules. So which rules means what? That which rules, in the sense that which governs, which gives us the knowledge of what, like principles of economics which govern economics. They are called the Arthashastra. So what are those principles are governing this entire art of warfare? Aeronautics, what are the principles that govern this, you know, flight? It's amazing how this Vaimanik Shastra is written. Many people don't believe in all that. But maybe the science is available as of now is not complete, but maybe in the past it was existing in its full form. What kind of food the astronaut must eat? What kind of alloy with which the space suit is made? It's all given in that. What kind of alloy with which you make a plane so that the radar cannot detect it? All that is given in that Vaimanika Shastra, aeronautics. So those are principles which govern that field. And knowing that, we are able to make the best of that field. So that is called Shastra. So as far as Vedanta is concerned, what are the principles that govern the functioning of the body, mind, intellect? How to transcend the body, mind, intellect? Our knowledge is, that is called Shastra. So two meanings of, first etymological meaning has two aspects. That which instructs, that which governs, rules. And then Shasana Trayate, that which protects us by its instructions. When we follow that, we are protected. Suppose we understand principles of economics and then we do our investment. We are protected or not? What do they say? The famous line, read the offer document, something, something. Carefully before investing. Like that. You should read properly, then you know all the instructions. Then you are protected. Forget all the offer document. You read the flight ticket. When it comes now, what are the instructions? That also we won't read. And then when on small plane is there, and then you take extra luggage and go, then they will say your silver card does not apply to this, sir. 5 kilos extra is not valid on this flight. Then you pay extra. Otherwise, you say, I have a silver card, I know 15 kilos is normal, 20 kilos is allowed on my card. And you happily go at the counter. But you are not right that this is a small aircraft. It will not apply. So when we read, then it protects us. America, you know, they had a funny case. You must have known. An old lady, she spilled coffee on her leg. McDonald's coffee on her leg. And her leg got burned. She sued them. She got some millions of dollars because they did not write, you know, this coffee is extremely hot or this and this temperature or whatever it is. Here, coffee keeps falling every second. So that which protects us. So, Shasana Trayate. If we follow those instructions, we are protected. That is a Shastra. Now, what is the Prakarana Grantha? Prakarana Grantha, Prakarana literally means a topic. Grantha means that which is compilation actually. So on different topics connected to this subject is a compilation. Many of them will be actually preliminary. So one can study those to know the terms, terminologies, concepts, to be able to understand the Shastra Grantha properly. So that is called Prakarana Grantha. Introductory text. And the main text as a general translation. Now let us see the differences. What are the differences? First difference, Prakarana Grantha covers specific topics, introductory topics, need not be holistic, like Shastra covers every aspect. But Prakarana Grantha need not be covering every aspect. May also cover, but need not. Like Atma Bodh is a Prakarana Grantha. It will not cover all the topics which are required in the journey of a seeker. It covers some aspects, some analogies, some Tattva Bodh, Atma Bodh, Vivek Chudamani. They are called Prakarana Granthas. And they are necessary to learn because only then I can understand the Shastra Grantha properly. Like a simple example I will give you. If I say the word Atma, what comes to your mind?
Soul.
Oh, that's all English meaning. What does that mean? Soul means what?
That enlivens us.
That which enlivens us. So one person says that, knows that. Otherwise, the moment we say the word Atma, people think the soul which comes and goes. So they say, yeah, achi atma hai, ye buri atma hai, ye duratma hai, dushtatma hai, bhutatma, pretatma, bhatakti atma, what all one thinks. But literally the meaning of the word atma means I. Atma means only I. Now that I can be I as the body, I as the mind, I as the jiva, I as the atma, pure consciousness. In the Upanishads, the same word atma is used for in many levels. Now, if I don't know that the word atma means I, and the real meaning of the word I is Sachidananda Swarup Chaitanya Atma, I can read the Shastra, but I will get completely confused. I won't understand. So many people take the Gita and the Upanishad, they just start reading. Then they say, you know, it doesn't make any sense. Obviously, how will it make any sense? We didn't understand what is the concept. Then we have to come to the Gita. The main textbooks are holistic and they cover, they require us to understand the preliminary concept before. So preparatory text to study the main text is the Prakarana Grantha. So there is a sequence in which one should study. If we don't study in that sequence, confusion galore. So many people have so much confusion about this word Atma. They think Atma is one small thing residing inside the heart somewhere. All Atma, no, I know Swami, Atma is a part of the whole, you know, Amsha. We are a small part of that Lord. But Vedanta is saying, no, you are that infinite, you are not a part. How will I understand if I don't know only preliminary concepts? Maya. If I ask you what is Maya, what is our understanding of Maya?
That which is not.
That which is not.
Power, power of Lord.
Power of the Lord, because you are coming to Gita class. For many people, Maya means what? Money is Maya. Pleasure is Maya. This world is Maya. Moha. They confuse this Moha and Maya. Moha is different, Maya is different. So, exact clarity one must have. Otherwise, we will get confused. What is the real import, we will not understand. So you say renounce Maya. They think renounce the child, renounce the family, renounce money, renounce everything. But it literally means something else. So we have to understand. So preparatory books are very important to study what is the basic fundamental concept. See, if I study the fundamental books, I can study any main book. But if I directly go to only the main book, I cannot study. I won't understand anything. So that's a foundation. It's like A, B, C, D, I should know. Then I can open any book and read. If I don't know, then what will I do? So studying the essentials and can be studied independently. Now some of the Prakarana Granthas are such that they will even give the whole journey. You don't even need to read the main book. Like Vivek Chudamani gives the entire journey. From qualification of the student to Jivan Mukti and what happens after Jivan Mukti. Same way Tattva Bodh gives everything. Now then why should I study the main book? This gives in brief. This gives you some aspects. As I said, holistic growth, holistic knowledge is in the main books. Many doubts I may have, those all get cleared because of the main books. So the depth and anchoring happens properly when I also study the main books. But I cannot study the main books independently without the preparatory books. Master of the Prakarana Granthas is a must for understanding the Shastra. It is impossible to understand the Shastra Grantha without mastering the Prakarana Grantha. Now to know the depth of the holistic coverage, one studies the Shastra Grantha. Sometimes it is all, one difference also is there is that the Shastra Grantha is a revealed knowledge. Revealed knowledge means it is not human composition. Like the Veda, for us, in Sanatana Dharma, the Veda is the main text. You know, some people, when they ask, for Christians, what is the main text? Bible. For Muslims? Quran. For Hindus? Gita. Many will say Gita. But for the Hindus, it is the Veda, not a Dastanatra. The main text for the Hindus, the Sanatana Dharma followers, is Veda. Vedaha Pramanam is the word, is the Pramana means a valid means. They are revelations. Quiet moments the mind wishes, then the mantras are revealed, and then Vedavyasi compiled it in the form of a book. Otherwise, it's passed on through oral tradition. Now, that Vedic knowledge is not composition of human beings. Why? What is the greatness of that then? Human intellect is limited. It is colored with pride and prejudice also. Can this finite intellect ever know the infinite? It's not possible. But if this finite intellect is put aside, the infinite manifests through it. That is called a revelation. Even science accepts revelation. Archimedes was, he was taking bath, no? And then suddenly that struck him. And then what he did? He came out shouting, Eureka, Eureka, because Archimedes' principle struck him. Struck him means his mind is spontaneously tuning up to it, and then all the ego, everything put aside, then the knowledge just reveals. So that is called revelation, where it is not conditioned by human thinking, human intellect. Hence, that is the main knowledge. That's the main Shastra book. The Prakarana Granthas are compositions of human beings. Not that these are ordinary human beings and they are any, you know, their compositions are any less. Shankaracharya wrote Tattva Bodh, Atma Bodh, Vedansa written by Swami Sadananda. Like that, they are great masters whom you have written. But these are knowledge, these are what will help us to reach that capability to study the Vedic books. Hence, some are revealed, the main texts are revealed knowledge, and the Prakarana Granthas are most probably they are compositions of saints and sages. Now, this much is about Prakarana Grantha and Shastra Grantha. This Advanced Vedant course is going to take out many, many things from different Prakarana Granthas and Shastra Granthas combined. More than some 30 books, Vivek Chudamani, Atma Bodh, Tattva Bodh, Vedansa, Dakshinamurti Stotram, like that. In the introduction, if you see the introductory, you know, notes which are there, that is all given there. So many Shastras from there is all picked up. So the advantage of that is you don't have to read all the 30 and figure out your sequence. The sequence has been put in the course. Now to know the depth, then you can read each book separately. So this course has a combination of both Prakarana Granthas and the Shastra Grantha. Now any composition will always begin with an invocation. See, we are not studying one specific text. We are studying compilations from different texts. Why should I do Mangalacharana? You come across Mangalacharana in physics, chemistry, biology books, mathematics. Where else will come Mangalacharana? In spiritual books, you will come across Mangalacharana. Why should we sing the Mangalacharana? Why should the author start with Mangalacharana? Let us see. Okay, we will see that what is Mangalacharana, and then what is, why is it required. So what is a Mangalacharana? It can be one full verse. Complete verse can be a Mangalacharana. Like in your Vedant course material, the Mangalacharan of Vivek Chudamani is being used as an example. So it can be a whole verse. If you have your material, please take out the material. For this Advanced Vedant course, it is important that you must have your material with you, whether in hard copy or soft copy, because some of the verses are there in this which we have to chant. So it's on page 2, what is below.
Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tamagocharam Govindam Paramanandam Sadguru Tadgurum So this is called one verse, one full shloka. Now, a whole verse is there to invoke the grace of the Lord or the Guru or both. I will come to the meaning of that. But it can also be one single word indicating both. Like here the word is Govinda. So what is the meaning of this verse? Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam. Tam Agocharam. That Lord or that infinite reality which is incomprehensible by the senses. Incomprehensible by the senses. Because it's infinite, I cannot see it, I cannot feel it, I cannot think about it. So it is not available for usual modes of perception. The knowledge of my own infinite self is not available as an object. So it is agocharam. But then how to know it? The means to know it is Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam. Through the Siddhanta or the principles of Vedanta, when I study Vedanta systematically, Vedanta is a valid means of Govinda, who is the supreme bliss. So what Govinda indicates, Lord Krishna, means Bhagavan Vishnu himself. Who is he of the nature of supreme bliss? That very Lord is my own Sadguru also. Sadgurum. So the name of Shankaracharya's Guru is Govinda Bhagavat Pad. So the one word Govinda indicates both Bhagwan as well as the Guru. Pranatosmiham. I salute. So what is the literal meaning of the word? The verse there. I salute the Supreme Lord who is Govinda, who is my Sadguru, who is generally not known through usual modes of perception, but who is known through the study of the literal meaning of the verse. So now when we have these verses, every great master who has composed will always invoke the grace of the Lord and the blessings of the Guru before doing any composition. Sometimes it may be one word, sometimes it may be a whole verse. Sometimes it can be two separate verses also. One for the Lord and one for the Guru.
So here again in your course material, at the end of this lesson, on page 6, verses for reflection which are given, in that there are three verses. The first verse is given is from Tattva Bodha. Vasudevendra Yogindram Tattva Jnana Pradam Gurum Mumukshu Nam Hitarthaya Tattva Bodho Vidhiyate. Now here also the same thing. With the word Vasudeva, both the Guru and the Lord are indicated. Because Vasudeva is the name of Bhagavan Vishnu only. And same the word Vasudeva indicates Tattva. And Jnana Pradam Guru, who is the one who has given me knowledge. I salute the Lord, I salute that Guru. And for the benefit of the mumukshus, those who really want liberation, for all those people, mumukshunam hitarthaya tattva bodho vidhiyate. I am composing tattva bodho. So this is called invocation. So in the same verse, both Guru and God are invoked. Now the next two verses, if you see, these are in a composition called Vedanta Sar by Swami Sadananda. So in one verse he invokes the Guru, sorry, the Lord, the first verse, and then the second verse he invokes the Guru. So these are examples taken from different books. Akhandam Satchidanandam Atmanam Akhiladharam Ashraye Bhishta Siddhaye. So Aham ashraye. I take refuge. In whom? In the self. Atmanam aham ashraye. I take refuge in the self. See the word Atma is self. What is this Atma? It is akhanda. It is unbroken. The body is broken into so many parts. Mind also is broken by each and every thought. It keeps breaking. New thought keeps rising. Emotions, they come, they go. One emotion comes, the other is replaced. So there is a break. In the world outside also, everything is finite. Akhanda means infinite. That which is infinite. No break. Satchidananda, what is the nature of that? Sat, Chit and Anand. We will learn about this as we go along. Existence, consciousness and bliss. Avang manasa gocharam. Cannot be expressed by speech. Avang. Cannot be comprehended by the mind. Manasa gocharam. And is it some small little thing inside me? No. Akhila dharam. It is the substratum of the whole universe. Just imagine. The self in me is the self in all, which is the substratum of the whole universe. The entire creation, the source of that creation is not outside. The source of the creation is in my heart. That self I take refuge in. You know, one Zen master was asked by the student, from where did this whole creation come? And the master answered so beautifully. He said, from where this question came, not from where the creation came. Meaning that question came from the buddhi, and the buddhi is empowered by the self. From there the whole creation came. So that Atma, so this Atma is the Lord himself. Satchidananda means the Lord. So in this one verse, he has already conveyed that the Lord is your own self. Those who are what you call right students, they will get the point immediately, saying the self in me is your consciousness. One. Then the second verse is for the guru. So these are exclusive verses, one for the Lord, one for the guru. Arthatopyadvayananda. Arthatopyadvayanandan Atitadvaita Bhantaha Guruna Radhya Vedanta Saram Bhakshyathamati. So he says, Vedanta Saram Bhakshe, I expound Vedanta Saram, Yathamati, as per my understanding. Having done what? Guru Naradhya, having worshipped my Guru. Who is the Guru? Arthataha Api Advayananda. The name of the Guru is Advayananda. And he is living that meaning. Meaning he is the one who has crossed all duality. Dvaita means duality. Advaita means non-duality. Advayananda means one who revels in the bliss where there is no duality. Every bliss that we experience has a duality. So if I eat an ice cream, there is an ice cream which is an object, there is a subject which is I, then there is an enjoyment between both of them when the ice cream contacts the subject. Object contacts the subject, then the experience happens. So that experience is born out of duality. But that bliss where the duality is no more there, there is no subject, there is no object, that is called non-dual bliss. No, that how can there be some such joy? We have always experienced joy only out of it. In deep sleep, is there a subject? Is there an object? Is there a connection? No. Subject, object ceases. But still there is an experience of bliss. So in that way, when in the state of samadhi, when that person transcended the BMI identification, that person experiences that. So he says, Atita Dvaita Bhanata. He has crossed all the realms of duality. That guru of mine, who is named Advayananda, I salute to him, and then I start composing Vedanta Sari. So now these are the meanings, these are different aspects of invocation. So it can be one word, it can be one whole verse, it can be one verse which invokes both Guru and God, or it can be only two separate verses. Vedantic path in three words. Who am I? Inquiry. Keep asking, who am I? Who am I? Who am I? You will reach there. He's a king, master of abridging. So when he wrote Upadesh Sar, he finished invocation in one word. Why waste the whole verse for it, it seems. One word. First word of Upadesh Sar is Karturajnaya. First verse is Karturajnaya Prapyate Phalam Karma Kimparam Karma Tajyagam. You said, where is the invocation verse before this? The first word Kartu means Bhagwan. Over, invocation over in that word. So it can be anything, it can be one verse, it can be one word, it can be many verses. Now, why is this invocation important? In spiritual, see, this is not actually related to only spiritual life. In our culture, this is the practice to invoke grace of Bhagwan and the Guru before anything which we do. Because the house and Bhagwan is the owner of the house and I am only a servant of the Lord in this house. Who thinks like that? We think we are the owners of the house. Bhagwan gets some Bodhvita box and you ring that. Yes. Check nicely. So before anything auspicious, anything good we start, we invoke the Lord's grace. Why is this important to us? Because when we invoke, we fill our heart with humility, devotion and surrender. That whatever is happening really by grace of Bhagavan and blessings of the Guru. Humility, devotion, purity and strength are very important. Because these are real strengths. If I do it without this, what happens? Will I not be successful? One can be successful in spite of Bhagwan and the Lord, Guru, they don't want our invocation. But when we invoke, literally invocation means what? You know, somebody went and asked, one small child went and asked Gurudev, is prayer not begging? What is the difference between prayer and begging? In begging also you are asking, give me this, give me that. Prayer also you are asking to the Lord, begging. So what is the difference? So Gurudev said, prayer is not begging, prayer is invocation. It is invoking the higher in you. There is a higher aspect in your own personality. You have to invoke that. Which means it is surrendering the lower. So any invocation, any spiritual composition especially, when we want to do, then we invoke the God's grace and the Guru's blessings so that our ego is put aside. When ego is put aside, all the challenges that also come on the way, we can deal with it with strength. So they are the source of our strength. Any obstacles that come, we will have the courage that Bhagwan is with me, I have invoked the grace of the Lord and I can overcome. Every class we begin how? Sahana Vavatu, with invocation. You know, in this book, you see, there's a very nice line on page number 2. Patanjali, says Patanjali, when he is writing his Mahabhashya on Panini's sutras, grammar. See, to come to give commentary on grammar, you may say, why invocation is required? Grammar commentary it is. But that's why I'm saying that invocation is not limited to spiritual work. It is any work that I do, I invoke the grace of the Lord because my capacities are so limited. Infinite power can function through me if I put aside my ego. So what he wrote, you see before, you repeat after me. Mangala Dini. मंगलमध्यानि मंगलांतानि च शास्त्राणि प्रचन्ते आयुष्मत्पुरुषाणि च भवन्ति अध्येतारश्च सिद्धार्थास्युः। What he says, Mangala Vini, invocation is there in the beginning. Mangala Madhyani, it is there in the middle. Mangala Antani Cha, and it is there in the end also. And only such a person who has invoked like this, the Supreme, meaning who never forgets that all happens by God's grace, Guru's blessing. The words of such a person, Shastrani Prachante Ayushmat Purushani Cha, they will stand the test of the time and they will also make the reader understand what the writer wants them to understand. Adhyetara means the reader, the student who is studying, will be able to understand what the person who is the author is writing. Only if the person is able to do it like this, meaning do it with the bhav that I am not the karta, Bhagwan is the karta. Empty oneself. So when we empty ourselves, what happens to us? What all we did not even think is possible becomes all possible. Because our mind and intellect can have many limitations, many ideas, notions, which can be obstructing. If those are removed by invocation, then the free flow of knowledge will happen. And hence invocation is very important. In our culture, before we start studying also, we start invoking. Saraswati Namastubhyam, Paradekamalupinim, Vidyarambham Karishyami, Siddhir Bhavatume Sada. Invocation is there right from the beginning of the day till we go to sleep, keep on invoking Bhagavan. So the ego gets surrendered, we understand we are only instruments, and really speaking, who is the guru? Bhagavan only is the guru. Krishnam Vande is the guru. How can one individual be the guru? Knowledge in any single field, is it limited? You think about it. In music, you may say, what song it is? Seven swaras only are there. 100% it is limited only. It is not limited. No. Any field you see, art, music, science, literature, every field, one single field, knowledge is infinite. How is it possible for human intellect to even comprehend one field? And this I am talking about external or more secular subjects. The knowledge of the self is the subtlest and which is not perceptible by the body, mind, intellect. How to even express that knowledge and how to make that person who is studying the knowledge even understand that? In Vedanta it is said, Ascharyo Vakta Kushalo Asya Labdha. To get a speaker on the self is a wonder. And to get a listener is a greater wonder. And then that listener has got the knowledge of the self is still greater wonder. Because how to convey that knowledge of the self using only the speech? But it all becomes possible when the teacher puts aside the ego. Generally a Sadguru has no ego at all. Like Shankaracharya doesn't have ego which he has to put aside and then write, and when the writing is over, then again his ego comes back. It is not like that. But when the ego, when one writes composition, one consciously invokes the grace of the Lord, puts aside the ego. So this is why it is Mangalacharan. And also the strength comes to the person that Bhagavan's grace and Guru's blessings are always with me. Because individually my willpower can be weak. I can give up when obstacles come. But when I know that God's grace is with me, and this cannot be done only in the beginning of the program. That's why he says Mangalalini, Mangala Madhyani, Mangala Antani. Same thing we have to apply in our day. So your exercise for this week is, last week I gave you one exercise, you remember? You have to close down. And then you have to write and put every day. We'll see more about it in the end of the class. So this week the exercise is, every day as you begin the day, in the middle of the day, and at the end of the day, you have to do one invocation. And don't simply say Om Shanti 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 Shanti. No use. Invoke means put aside. Feel that Bhagwan alone is, His grace alone is real. Everything happens only by His grace and blessings. With that bhav, whichever invocation you choose. Sanavati is the simplest one. And it's a Vedic invocation, Sanavati is not an ordinary invocation. It's a proper Vedic Shanti mantra. So you should chant it also nicely and feel the bhav.
Invocation can be a way of thanking or
because that you can express gratitude through that.
You are saying at the end of the day also we invoke. But end of the day we are not starting something. We are ending our day.
Yes, so invocation is not only to start. Invocation is to put aside the ego all the time. So you can end the day by thanking Bhagavan also. That's okay. You are invoking Bhagavan only, no? If you say Om Kai Navacha Manasendriva Buddhyatmana Vapati Deshva Bhavat Karomi Yadya Sakalam Parasmai Narayana Yeti Samarpayami. Surrendered everything to Bhagavan. And Karacharana Kritamba Kayajam Karmajam Bhava Shravananayanajam Bhava Manasam Vaparadham Vihitama Vihitamba Sarva Veta Kshamasva Jaya Jaya Karunabdhe Shri Deva Shambho. Knowingly, unknowingly, with my body, mind, speech, actions, whatever I have done, please pardon all the limitations and all mistakes. Why should you pardon? Because you are, Bhagavan says, why should I pardon? Mahadeva Shambho, you are Mahadeva, Karunabdhe, you are ocean of compassion. So you're invoking. So invocation can have the bhav of surrender. That's the main aspect of invocation. It can be through thankfulness, it can be through seeking forgiveness, it can be through invoking qualities, any of those. What is the bhav? I am zero, Bhagavan is everything. That's the main bhav of invocation. That I am nobody. And it is a fact that I am nobody. It is not something cooked up. The flute is nothing unless the breath of the air, breath of the Lord passes through the flute. What is the flute? It's zero. No music will come out of the flute. We all are like that. Flute. So what will you do as exercise?
Morning.
Invocation in the morning.
Middle of the
invocation in the afternoon. Invocation at
night.
Simple invocation is Sahanavatu in the morning. You want to do same through the day also three times, no problem. Or you want to do separate, if you are used to any specific prayers, do that. Idea is to remember Bhagavan. In our culture, generally it will be said, do in the morning, Karagre Vasate Lakshmi. In the middle of the day, you remember Saraswati Devi. At the end of the day, you say, what I just said, Karacharana Kritamba, or Kalina Vacha. But different things which are said. But otherwise you can remember anything which will help to invoke the Lord. In the Google Drive, I will put a few like this, what we just discussed. So that you can learn those with the meaning and say it. Or whichever you like, you can say. So this is the purpose of invocation. Now every composition begins with the invocation. Work of the Lord alone is perfect. All other work is polluted with ego and selfishness. So to remove that, invoke the Lord. Now in the course material, they are given four. God is talking and I am listening. meaning to that extent the ego has become lesser and I can really hear the voice of conscience. This is the right thing to do, that is not the right thing to do, and I am able to follow. When I am full of ego, even if my conscience is telling me something, I am not able to listen. So second stage, God talks and I listen. Meaning that humility has come in. Voice of conscience is more clear. Third stage, neither talks, both listen. What does that mean? Ego is not expressing so much. Nor God is talking. Meaning, there is an acceptance of whatever life brings, one is dealing with it equanimously. No expectation is there. But the fourth stage, neither is talking, nobody is listening. Meaning what? Jiva Bhav is also gone, Ishwar Bhav also gone, there is only silence, infinite consciousness where there is no creation also. We'll come to it, that's the last stage. That's the divine presence, nothing else is there, only pure Brahman. Till Jiva and Ishwara is there, these three stages apply. Jiva talks, Ishwara listens. Ishwara talks, Jiva listens. Jiva and Ishwara both are not talking, but karma is happening. Last stage, no karma because no creation, nothing is there. Only pure consciousness and the presence. So invocation helps me to put aside my ego. For that, this thing is given here. Now comes the next topic. That any text will have this Anubandha Chatushtaya. Vedantic text especially, I am saying. Anubandha Chatushtaya means these four aspects, preliminary considerations. They serve as a foreword or as an introductory note. So if you go to a bookshop, how do you choose a book? Do you see only the title? First you see the title and then you read the synopsis. You read who is the author. Is he accredited author, well-known author, or at least, if not well-known, at least this. What is the subject matter? Is it making any sense to me? So like that, first, how do we know that which book to study in Vedanta? We should know certain basic aspects about the book. Whether I am qualified to read it or not, at least that much I should know. So the first consideration is an adhikari. Who is an adhikari? I will tell you about this in detail, right now only listing. Meaning a student who is qualified to receive the knowledge of the text. Literally adhikari means qualified student. See, adhikara word does not mean right. In Sanskrit, adhikara means qualification. One meaning is qualification. Adhikara means qualified student. Vishaya means the main subject of the text. The text may cover many other things also. But what is the main subject? Suppose I ask you, what is the main subject of Bhagavad Gita? What will you say? Krishna is the main subject. Okay. Dharma Gnana, Brahma Gnana,
Art of Living,
Art of Living,
Moksha Shastra,
Manual of
Life.
Sorry?
Manual of Life.
Main topic of the Gita is Brahma Gnana. Jiva Brahma Ikya. The oneness of the Jiva and Brahman is the main topic of the Gita. Values, you know, living a dharmic life, doing our duty. Those are also topics, but they are not the main topic. They are preparations for the main subject. So Jiva Brahma Ikya, or if you say oneness with Krishna, that. Same. So in any book, we should first find out what is the main topic. That's called Vishaya, main subject. Then Prayojan, what is the purpose for which the adhikari is studying and what is the result that the adhikari will get? If I want to get Brahma Jnana, I should study Vedanta. If I want to know about physics, should I study Vedanta? No, the prayojan will not be served because physics is my objective. But the subject matter of Vedanta is not physics, so why will I study that? So the objective must be clear to us. The purpose and the result. That why this book is studied. So that's called prayojan. If you want to understand about devotion, then you study devotional texts like Ramayana. But there are many people who study Ramayana not for devotion text. They want to do research in literature. Or they want to, let us say, find out about description, what was the natural ecosystem in the Ramayana time. So what type of trees were there, what type of rivers were there, what type of birds were there, all that. Then they are understanding from there. Or somebody wants to know 9 types of rasas in Ramayana. So they will get, but that is not the main subject of the text. And so the prayojan of this person is also not that main problem. Prayojan of the person is, I want to study about ecosystem, I want to study about Navarasa, I want to study so many other things, warfare, weapons, so many things. So what is the prayojan? Why should a person study the text? And sambandha, what is the relationship between the text and the subject matter? And will it lead me to the result which I want? So now each one let us see one by one. Adhikari, who is an adhikari? In any field we require qualifications or not, except politics. Everywhere else we require qualification. Can I simply go and join the army? No, they will check now. Height, weight, the physical qualities, patriotism, so many things they will test. Then only one gets army entry. Medicine, medical entrance one has to be. If you want to go into IIT, IIT, JEE, that exam you have to give. So qualification is required. For voting, minimum 18 years. Everyone qualification is required. But the best part is, in spiritual life, people think no qualification is required. And not only that, it is exact ulta. Rejected, depressed, despondent, desperate people come to spiritual life. That's what they think. And especially if you are young and you go, they will say, "Koi problem hai? Why are you going there?" Because they think it is some either the refuge of all the dejected, depressed people, or it is a post-retirement thing. When you have nothing better to do about devotion, then you study devotional texts like Ramayana. But there are many people who study Ramayana not for devotion text. They want to do research in literature. Or they want to, let us say, find out about description, what was the natural ecosystem in the Ramayana time. So what type of trees were there, what type of rivers were there, what type of birds were there, all that. Then they are understanding from there. Or somebody wants to know 9 types of rasas in Ramayana. So they will get. But that is not the main subject of the text. And so the prayojan of this person is also not that main prayojan. The prayojan of the person is, I want to study about ecosystem, I want to study about Navarasa, I want to study so many other things. Warfare, weapons, so many things. So what is the prayojan? Why should a person study the text? And sambandha. What is the relationship between the text and the subject matter? And will it lead me to the result which I want? So now each one let us see one by one. Adhikari. Who is an adhikari? In any field we require qualifications or not. Except politics. Everywhere else we require qualifications. Can I simply go and join the army? No, they will check na height, weight, the physical qualities, patriotism, so many things they will test. Then only one gets army entry. Medicine, medical entrance one has to give. If you want to go into IIT, IIT, JEE, that exam you have to give. So qualification is required. For voting,
18 years.
Minimum 18 years. Everywhere qualification is required. But the best part is, in spiritual life, people think no qualification is required. And not only that, it is exact ulta. Dejected, depressed, despondent, desperate people come to spirituality. That's what they think. And especially if you are young and you go, they will say, koi problem hai. Why are you going there? Because they think it is some, either the resort, you know, the refuge of all these dejected, depressed people, or it is a post-retirement plan. When you have nothing better to do, what to do? Go to spirituality. This requires qualification. Even a flight, if you go, before that takeoff happened, they check everything, no? Will you sit in a flight where nothing is checked? The flight just landed, they are not refueling it, they are not cleaning it, the pilot has not changed, nothing they do. Will you go and sit? But here we want to take off in meditation, but our flight is not checked only. And happily I am sitting every day to do meditation. Are you? But no fine tuning, nothing has happened. And then what will happen in such a flight if you go? Crash only. So adhikara is very important in spiritual life. So who is a qualified aspirant? Akhandananda Maharaj says very nicely, ruchi or samarthya, dono hona chahiye. I may have interest, but I am not capable. I have great interest in surgery, but am I qualified? Will anybody allow me to do surgery? I have great interest I have. I read books and books on surgery, but no capability. How will I do? I am not qualified yet, just because I have interest. If I have interest, then I cultivate the qualification, then I go into the field. Both are important. There are people who are very capable and qualified, but have no interest in it. They have been pushed into it by whatever, some pressure. Family pressure, peer pressure, financial pressure, some reason. They are into that field. And typically it happens with lot of engineers. They take up engineering and then they regret, ayyo, why did I take? And finally do MBA and sell some water machine. Something. Ruchi is very important, especially in Vedanta. Ruchi must be there, then samarthya. That makes a person adhikari. Now every text is addressed to a certain class of students and it gives a certain set of qualities. They will benefit from that text. If anybody else studies that book, they won't benefit. You can just go through it. But the required benefit will not come at all. But if the same thing is read by a qualified person, we'll get it. Now it is not to dissuade somebody from studying. It is to cultivate those qualities. That what are the type of qualities required to study Vedanta? And to live it. It's not a book, it's not a textual study, it is to transform my life. And it is subtlest knowledge. How will I get subtlest knowledge without tuning up my equipment? Now radio, if I have to get music, what I have to do? I have to go to that frequency now. What is it called? 91.4 FM.
90.
I don't know what frequencies are, but I'm just saying. Those are frequencies. You have to tune to that. Then that music will come. In that same way here. These are not to dissuade somebody. These are to tune up. Some of these are here. Pure heart, peaceful mind, free from cravings, desires of liberation. These are qualities that a seeker requires. So the Atmabodh verse tells us that. I'll take it as we go along. So adhikari means a qualified student. Now in spiritual life or even in any other field, the attainment of a goal depends mainly on the adhikar. So we have a principle in Vedant that if the knower contacts the known, knowledge has to arise. Yes or no? Eyes are the knower. Thermos is the known. If the eyes see the thermos, the knowledge of thermos should arise or not? If the thermos is there, eyes are seeing, but the knowledge of thermos is not arising. What does that mean?
Blind. No vision.
Either there is a blindness, or there is a defect in the eye, or I don't know that this is called thermos. So where is the defect? Is the defect in the known?
No.
Is the defect in the knowledge? The defect is in the knower. So if the known is there and the knower is contacting the known and the knowledge is still not arising, the reason is what? The knower has not tuned up properly. How does it apply in Vedanta? The known is Atma. It is there or not? Anybody has a doubt? Atma is there in everybody. We can't live without Atma. The known is there. And the teacher is giving the knowledge also. Tat, Tvam, Asi. That thou art. Still the realization is not happening. Why? This knower who is here has not the right qualifications. Because if the right qualification is there, the moment the teacher says Tattvamasi, the student will realize instant, immediately. But if that immediate realization is not happening, what does that mean? I have to still develop. So that is called an adhikar. And this adhikari is the main aspect to attain any goal. It doesn't depend on anything outside. So a very beautiful verse in Vivek Kulamani, which says, Adhikarena ma shastrek phala siddhir visheshana. Upaya desha kaladya sandhyasmin sahakarena. The attainment of the goal depends primarily on the qualified aspirant. Date, time, place, objects, they all are secondary. One may have the best of all those. You know, people go to IIT, ISB, IIM, all that. Best of places, best of teachers, best of facilities to stay, this, that, everything. But if the mind is not ready, then nothing will be achieved. Shankaracharya, did he go to any IIT? Nothing he went. Jesus went to any IIM? No. Gautam Buddha went to ISB? No. But what they have established has lasted millenniums together. Tell me one multinational which has lasted 600 years. It's not possible. But these institutions, from Buddha, he thought it was formally established. He trained some 500 monks. They all went across. Today, Buddhism is one of the biggest growing, fastest growing religions in the world. Why? Because inner qualification, power. So even in attainment of any goal, any physical, material goal outside also, Dr. Kalam, did he have best of the facilities? He used to throw newspaper to earn money so that he will go and, you know, study. But Dr. Kalam had the inner qualifications. He developed them. And he became from a fisherman's son to nuclear scientist and one of the best presidents of our country. So that is this. Adhikari means that. A qualified aspirant. So internal qualities, if we don't have, external things are useless. Suppose I have a computer, but I don't have knowledge of computing. You know, many, you know, when computer was introduced in this country, it was in school. 80286 was the first model. 8088 was the first model. Then came 80286. Then 386, 486, like that it came. So, when it came, we used to learn computer in the school. 8 standard, we used to teach Pascal, COBOL, like that they teach. My aunt was a typist. She's a typist. She knows typing properly. So somebody asked her, do you know computers? She says, no, but I know typing. I can manage the computer easily. Because they actually thought that what? Just the keyboard is different and on screen is a euro paper. I will do typing. My speed is 120 words per minute. I can do computers. How do they know what is the computer? Because no knowledge is there. So externally a dabba is kept in front of them. Then they wonder, are there koi galat ki dab gaya? Because computer is like that. You go take the mouse, put it somewhere, and then you click. And something opened, then they wonder, kya hua? I said, you know typing, no, manage it now. So you can have a dabba, but nothing will work. Knowledge is required. Externally, people have many facilities. Same way, I can bring meditation mat, meditation clothes, meditation light, meditation fragrance, meditation prasad, everything for meditation. But internally, not ready.
Buddhism has come up so much because of these emphasis on these practices.
That let them come up.
There's a lot of emphasis on meditation and how to do using all these equipment. Maybe it is helping.
No, there's no doubt. See, external help is always there, but until inner qualification required is cultivated, nothing will happen. That's the point here. Even in our culture, those who want to use, they have no, you go outside the temple, enough props are there. Ye agarbatti le lo, ye photograph le lo, ye dhoop le lo, ye deep le lo, ye sab kuch le lo, all props are there, but itna sab karne ke baad Bhagwan mein man laga kya? Lag bhi sakta hai, lekin sirf itna lene se nahin lagega. That's the point. Not that you should not use external props, please use happy. But until that right qualification is there, nothing will happen. So this is adhikar. Then comes vishaya. What is the subject matter? The main subject matter of the text, as I say. As far as Vedanta is concerned, what is the main subject matter of the text? Brahma Vidya is the main subject matter. Knowledge of who am I truly. Jiva Brahma Aikya, that's a technical word. The oneness between the individual and the universal. That I am not this one limited entity, I am pure consciousness. That is the main subject matter of any Vedantic book. Even a devotional book. Because the nature of Bhagavan is Satchidananda. Then what is the prayojan? Seekers of liberation, they want liberation. They study Vedanta for that. Some people may say, my prayojan is, I know quantum physics, I know biology, I know politics, I know Vedanta also. It is one extra feather in my cap. Even when we come to study advanced Vedanta course, what is our prayojan? We should be clear. Is our prayojan that I want to realize my own true self? Or is my prayojan that, you know, Swamiji, I have a lot of conflict in my relationships. I think Vedanta can help. Vedanta, some of the principles can help, but is that the main prayojan of studying Vedanta? That we should ask. Some people say, I will complete the course, I will get certificate, then I will start earning money. Prayojan can be anything. I have a certified thing, you know. Then I can also start taking classes and charging. Sure. For a Vedantic student, what is the main prayojan of studying any book? For some people, it is I must be able to quote, you know, left and right, this book also, that book also, and give big prayojan. Vedantic student, the main prayojan is I want moksha. I want to know who am I. Not knowing who am I, everything else I know is useless. So moksha is a param prayojan. It is called supreme purpose or the result of the study. And then comes sambandha. What is the relationship between the subject matter and the text? For example, food and hunger. Food is there and you are hungry. But if you don't know that this food can quench my hunger, what is the point? You may say, what a weird example that is. If you go to certain places like Northeast and some other places, you know, then to distinguish what you can eat and what you need, what you cannot eat may become difficult sometimes because you are not used to that type of the delicacies which they prepare. So you may wonder what to do with this Food is may be right in front of you, but you may not know that this is eatable. In the same way, knowledge is there. I want liberation, but I know don't know that the study of this book will give me liberation. Like example, Gita, as I said, the study of Gita is meant for moksha shastra. Now I don't know that. I know that Gita can make my life better, so I benefit that much only. So the sambandha has to be established clearly. That the prayojan that you want is fulfilled by this text, by the subject matter of this text. Of course, you have to be an adhikari for it. So an adhikari, when he studies the book, the subject matter which is given in that will be able to discover the result. That is this. So four we have chosen. Now you identify in this Atmabodh verse all the four. That's your exercise now. Let us chant the verse first. Tapo bhikshina papanam.
Tapo
bhikshina papanam. Shantanam vitaraginam. Mumukshu nama pekshoyam. Atma bodho vidhiyate. Here he says, tapo bhikshina papanam. By tapas, those who have destroyed their sins. Shantanam, who are peaceful. Vitaraginam, who have become dispassionate. Mumukshunam, who are desires of liberation. For such people, Atma Bodho Vidhiyate. I am elaborating Atma Bodho. Now tell me which are the words which are indicating Adhikari. Don't look at your book. Don't read your course material and say Achan. Adhikari is indicated by which words? Tapobhi. Shantana. Mokshuna. Two more words. Vitaragina. One more word. Are we now giving every word? Ho gaya, ho, count ho gaya. Tapobhi counted, Shantanam counted, Vitaraginam counted, Mumukshunam counted. One more word. Kshina papanam. Tapobhi kshina papanam. By tapas, those who have destroyed their sins, then who have become peaceful, who have become dispassionate, want liberation. Actually, Mumukshunam is the prayojan. Mumukshunam is the prayojan. But you may use even here if you like. So, adhikari is this. What is the Vishaya? Simplest. Vishaya is Atma Bodh, knowledge of my true nature. Prayojan, Mumukshunam. And then Sambandha, Eki Varavacha. By the law of remainder, everything else is negated. Kya Vacha? That is this. Vidhiyate, meaning this book will speak about Atma Bodh, which will lead you to this realization of the self. So that when I study the invocation words itself, I can identify that am I fit to study this book or not. You know, like this, there are verses in Tulsi Ramayana also. Before you begin the study of Tulsi Ramayana, for whom it is, what is the subject matter, what is the prayojan, what is the result, everything is given there. So if you say, no, no, I don't want devotion for Ram, don't waste your time. Close the book, put it aside, read something else. So this is Prakarana Grantha, Shastra Grantha, then Mangalacharan, and then Anubandha Chatushtaya. Chatushtaya means four. Anubandha Chatushtaya. What are the four? Adhikari, Vishaya, Sambandha, Prayojan. Four. So our lesson two ends here. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Guru Namah. Hari Om.